Good afternoon. So I welcome you, all of you, to this session on high-tech agriculture. We have a very interesting panel out here. We have Jinesh, who's a seasoned investor in AgTech. And we have very three smart AgTech entrepreneurs, Krishna, Amar, and Ranjit, who are not just the pioneers in this sector, but also demonstrated that technology can be integrated in the agricultural supply chain, not only in India, but across the world. So just before I hand over mic to my fellow panelists, let me just make a few opening remarks to set the context. So, you know, when we talk about technology in agriculture, be it sensors, drones, IoTs, lidars, etc., you know, what does it mean and what it is trying to solve? So to my understanding, I think ultimately what it is trying to solve is the biggest problems that I see in agricultural supply chain world over, and more so in India. That's information and data. You know, or let me put it like timely information and accurate data. I think that is one of the biggest missing link, which causes a lot of inefficiencies, lack of transparency, and farmer gets less income and leads to a lot of food loss in the supply chain, all those issues. And once you have data, out of course, the efficiency starts seeping into the system. For example, if you have, let's say, real-time data on soil moisture, soil NPK profile, you know how much to irrigate, where exactly to irrigate, what kind of fertilizer to be provided, how much have to be provided. So you can be very precise. The technology makes farm management solutions, supply chain management solutions available to farmers and various stakeholders in the supply chain. You can also do monitoring of post-harvest farm produce during the storage, during the distribution, etc. So all in all, it brings in more efficiency, more transparency, and, you know, brings more income in the hands of farmer. And it's not just the farmer who benefit. If you look at the entire supply chain, the input companies are selling to farmers, the output companies are buying from farmers, the banks were lending to farmers. You know, they are able to do much better KYC, they can assess the credit worthiness. And last but not the least, the crop insurance companies, which has been a very sort of challenging issue for India in general. You know, technology can play a big role in assessment of the risk, in online monitoring of crop cutting experiments, which is an integral part of crop insurance, and also in settlement of a lot of insurance claims. So clearly, there's a huge role which technology can play in agriculture, and that's why we are seeing a significant surge in adoption of technology. You know, by some estimate, it's said that about 40 million IoT devices as of now in agriculture installed somewhere in the world, and that number probably can touch 80 million IoT devices by 2020. And each IoT device has the capability to transmit millions of data points, and I will let the entrepreneur talk about that. As far as investor interest is concerned, this has been a remarkable year globally. For the first time, we have seen a $200 million VC deal in AgTech when SoftBank led investment into Plenty. I'm sure many of you will be aware, Plenty is a vertical farming firm which uses a lot of internet-connected devices to improve the productivity. And they're claiming that productivity can go as much as 350 times using 1% of the water which is required in the conventional agriculture. So that is some claim. If I talk about a couple of other deals, John Deere invested in Blue River Technology. You know, and what Blue River does, they basically use robotics, computer vision, and some bit of AI ML algorithm to detect, monitor each and every plant in the farm. So you know which is the you know, where are the weeds, and you can be very specific in applying herbicides. And John Deere paid almost $300 million for this acquisition. Likewise, DuPont acquired Granular, which is a farm analytics platform. So we've seen phenomenal amount of investor interest, and you know, we know that a lot of investors are looking at India now from an AgTech perspective. So probably I'll pause here and get, you know, Ranjit into the discussion. Ranjit, you've been you know, working on IoT devices, cloud computing, etc., for the dairy industry. And dairy is one of the most important sector for Indian food processing industry, almost $50 billion, 150 million ton of production, and about 7 crore farmers involved in it. So just talk about a little bit about why have you chosen this sector, what kind of opportunities do you see, and what kind of challenges you face when you started selling your solutions to some of the large dairy companies whom you're working with?
Yeah, thank you, Hemendra, for that. Good afternoon, everyone. So as Hemendra said, Agri is too vast. So when we looked at Agri across the gamut of things, we realized that unless to take a solution into the market, we have to get focused and solve specific business problems. So what we did was, instead of taking a wide sweep at Agri, we looked at various crops and then picked milk as the first crop to go after. We want to pick a scalable crop, right? So you could actually view, if you view milk as a crop, 1/3 of Indian Agri is milk. Roughly 7.5% of India's GDP is milk. If you just take the milk value and the animal value, it comes to 7.5%. So we thought, let's go a little more deeper, keep all the other crops aside, look at milk as a specific crop, and see what problems we can solve. So in that context, what we did was, we are an IoT company, so we started building out an IoT platform where you can do two things. One, the ability to plug in sensors very easily on the southbound interface. Because any problem that you pick, there are a bunch of sensors you would need to integrate with. Right? So you need a platform where, agile platform where you can actually plug in sensors very quickly. Number two, the ability to develop applications very quickly on the northbound platform. Because every business problem needs some application to solve the problem. So we want to evolve towards some sort of an IoT app store type of a scenario, where it's very easy to develop applications on the northbound interface. So this entire stack, including the sensors, the hardware that controls the sensors, the cloud platform, and the applications is our core product. We call it a full stack IoT solution. And this stack, we apply it to the dairy supply chain. What do I mean by dairy supply chain? You have the farm, where you have small farmers producing milk. From the farm, the milk comes to a milk aggregation point, milk collection centers. From there, milk goes to a milk chilling center. From the milk chilling center, it goes into the processing plant. And our focus was to have sensors across the supply chain. For example, on the farm side, we have animal wearables. It's like a Fitbits for cows that can detect a lot of animal data and send it to the cloud. And then on the milk aggregation side, we integrate with milk analyzers that can detect how much is the added water, what's the adulteration and composition and all of that. And on the chilling side, how do I ensure that the milk, it's perhaps the most perishable crop vis-a-vis all the crops that you see there. And it's not just a plain vanilla temperature monitoring. You also need to do a very domain intense monitoring. Are they actually cleaning that equipment where the milk is stored so that the bacterial load doesn't go up? Is there a somatic cell count, profile change as the milk is getting chilled? And the idea is the data gathered at one end should be correlatable with the data gathered at the next stage so that you don't look at each of these nodes in the supply chain in isolation. You look at it as a whole and start making sense out of this data. And then disseminate this information to all the stakeholders, dairy companies, the veterinary doctors, the paravets, the farmers, and all of them, with four objectives. One, improving yield. Two, reducing cost. Build in traceability. And four, enable more data-driven decision making. And today, as we speak, we have about a couple of billion liters of milk flowing through the cloud. About 1 million farmers registered on the platform. So that's essentially what we do.
Just one question. When you started selling this product to the dairy companies, which are not used to such kind of technologies, what were the typical challenges you faced and how did you overcome that in terms of adoption by the dairy companies that are there in India?
And our problem was amplified by the fact that just about less than half of the dairy is regulated. So you have the government dairies, you have the Amuls, the KMFs and all that. About 45% is them, and then 55% is private. So obviously, the government dairies go with the tender process and all of that. So that makes things even more complex because you're trying to do a tender for a technology that doesn't exist, right? So let's talk about the easier problem, the private. So in the private side, they're so focused on acquiring, collecting the good old dirty milk and taking it to the market, because that itself is a huge market. As someone at the panelist in the morning mentioned, there is still high-quality milk or organic milk, and all of them is still not into this into the mix yet. And people are used to working on low margins. So what we did was we had to show them per liter efficiencies improving. So we went through a long trial period. So it's not a very when we started, it was not a very investor friendly approach, because you have to prove things. So it doesn't grow month on grow at 20-30%. You need to put the solution, show that it grows, show that it works, and talk to the CXO and the board. The larger tier one dairy, so what we did was two things. One, we picked the most progressive dairy because we wanted good case studies. And we started approaching them at the board level, saying that, look, your balance sheet looks like this. I can have a solution with which your balance sheet can look different. And here is the proof of the pudding. But if I talk to your head of procurement, he is just happy doing, one-on-one. He's focused on, procuring milk, not breaking operations. So do you want to... roll it out? And if it doesn't work, I'll take back the entire solution. Don't have to make a penny. So we're lucky to hit into a couple of progressive dairies who said, yes, I want my balance sheet to look better. Show me this work for 500 units, which is like 1% of the collection, and show me this works. We showed it works, and then they gave us the contract for their entire procurement. So a little bit of consultative selling to begin with, and looking at the first progressive guy was what it took. Then eventually then we would tell, look, that guy did this, do you want it? Kind of stuff that's a little easier, but still we are trying to struggle.
That's great, good to hear.